Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Total Biscuit. I'm here to ask and answer one simple question. WTF is Middle-earth, Shadow of Mordor? It's not Lord of the Rings, Shadow of Mordor. For some reason, I wonder if that was a deliberate attempt to detach it, disconnect it even, from the Lord of the Rings trilogy. It's possible. This game does do a few interesting things with the lore, to the ire of some. But regardless, this is a third-person character action game, and it is set in Middle-earth, and it's developed by Monolith. What have Monolith done? Oh, they've done many things. Many things indeed. Some good stuff. You remember Shogo Mobile Armor Division? Yeah, that was absolutely fantastic. But if you want something a little bit more well-known, what about No One Lives Forever? What about AVP 2? What about Tron 2? What about Fear? What about Condemned Criminal Origins? What about Gotham City Imposters? Maybe that wasn't quite on the level of the rest of them, but I liked it. It was fun. They also did a few questionable things, like, say, Matrix Online, Fear 2 Project Origin, which wasn't as good as the original, and Condemned 2, which was, again, a bit of a mess. Guardians of Middle-earth, yes, that console Dota-style Lord of the Rings game that eventually came to PC and is played by basically nobody, because why would you? But now, along comes Middle-earth Shadow of Mordor on many platforms, both the previous and current generation consoles, as well as PC. Now, the PC release date was bumped up a little bit, but it's still a week after the console release. And things got a little bit weird when I tried to actually get review code for this. Now, I don't do reviews, but the standard name for pre-release code in the industry is review code, so you request that and everyone kind of understands what you want. But we had problems getting it, which was a little bit weird. Most of the time, we're able to get a hold of pre-release stuff fairly easily. I mean, we have a pretty large channel. We're, for the most part, well-respected, so most people play ball. For some reason, we got nothing back outside of one PR company that wanted to do a brand deal and said, well, yeah, we can give it to you early, but only if you sign this brand deal, which was a paid promotional video, basically. And of course, for that, we said no, because we can't. That would compromise our integrity. It's as simple as that. But through various contacts here and there, I was able to get in at the 11th hour and actually play this game prior to release. So I have my impressions for you here. Thank God. Hopefully we don't get too much more of that. I'm going to do a full video, actually, on the practice of review copies at a later date. But yeah, the whole experience was just... it was grubby, to say the least. Didn't like it. But I can assure you, I am not being paid for this. Absolutely not. All right, let's head on over to the options menu, shall we? Now, there's been a bit of concern about the PC port. One, for the reason I just gave you, because no one's got the bloody thing. And secondly, because they announced that ultra textures in this game would require 6 GB of video RAM. 6 GB, that is a lot of video RAM. There are very few cards that actually have that. I own one of them. I own Titans, so they do, in fact, have 6 GB of video RAM, but even the new GTX 980s, the brand new hotness from NVIDIA, does not have that much video RAM. They only have 4 by default, if I recall correctly. So that's a bit crazy. However, that's not really a problem right now, at least in the pre-release version, because the Ultra Texture Pack, which is listed right there to the right-hand side, if you read that, isn't out yet. So even if you set this to Ultra, it's only actually running high. And I've got to say, if they think that the texture quality in this game is worthy of 3 GB of video RAM, I have to wonder what exactly they're smoking, because you can even see in the background the resolution of the clothing on the main character is not particularly good. Maybe you can't see it. It's kind of faded in the background. It's a YouTube video, so it's a little bit blurry, but I can clearly see on things like the belt buckles and even on the fur that it's not very high resolution at all, and the hair looks gnarly as well, although the facial quality is pretty good. So it's going to be a bit strange to see what's going to happen with people who are trying to play this on PC and trying to run Ultra, and of course, how improved the Ultra Texture Pack really is. We don't know. What I can say on high is that the texture resolution in general is not that great. And I'll show you plenty of it once we get into the game, because that's what we do. We like to lick walls. Outside of that, motion blur. You do actually have a couple of options for this, which is nice. Usually it's on or off, but you can actually put camera motion blur on and not object blur if you so desire. So, if you like that. I personally don't. Mesh quality ultra. Of course, lighting quality high. This is as high as it goes, by the way. You'll notice in the corner, which is quite nice, the game actually does give you some information, like high requires 200 megs more video memory than low. But as far as I know, there's nowhere that kind of adds everything up, and half of the tooltips are actually missing that information. So, as you can see, you know, there's none on ambient occlusion, and yet there's none on mesh quality either, but there's some on lighting quality, there's some on shadow quality, so it's a little bit inconsistent. I really appreciate all of this information over to the side right here. This is actually the sign of a good port, but information is missing on half of these options, so that's a little bit weird. Texture filtering here. It's a little strange that they said, hey, let's pick Ultra, and that's going to be anisotropic filtering 16 times. Okay, well, why didn't you just list it as anisotropic filtering 16 times? Wouldn't that make more sense? Well, apparently not. Yeah. So this will currently run on high, because the Ultra HD pack is not currently available. Ambient occlusion. Now, I did knock this down one notch, because I noticed that Ultra had a significant frame rate impact. So I knocked it down a little bit. Vegetation ranges on Ultra, and then everything else, including DirectX 11 tessellation, is all here. I couldn't tell you what the balls this thing is. Order independent transparency, alpha blending to occur on hair, and dynamic lighting to occur on each layer. It's a thing, I've turned it on. I'm not that tech savvy, that's all I gotta say. So, not too bad an options menu here. Not too bad. Again, I really do like the fact that things are listed in the way that they are. Let's have a look at some of the other options, shall we? So, game settings, you can individually adjust aim, camera, mouse aim, and mouse camera sensitivity, which is good. You can turn your combat prompts on or off if you like. And you can turn off things like enemy outlines and combat hints if you don't want that stuff on. Vibration is on by default, which makes no sense because I don't have a controller plugged in, but hey, it obviously doesn't really make any difference. Keyboard and mouse. Okay, so rebinding. Good news and bad news. Good news, you can rebind the keys, and there are secondary key options. Bad news, this game has the good old problem of having multiple actions bound to the same key. Most of the time, this does not cause an issue, with the exception of this little devil right here. Wraith, Stun, Drain, and Drop Down are all on the same button. Now, this can cause problems, especially if you're climbing on something. Instead of doing the Wraith, Stun, or Drain, you can actually accidentally drop down onto a ledge, which is not particularly brilliant. But most of this works fine. Admittedly, I would much prefer them to unbundle all of this stuff and give it individual key bindings if we so desire. This one in particular is the one that's caused me the most problems. Everything else seems to work fine. And then outside of that, you can, if you want, move around the menus using the keys, but you don't have to. It's all fully mouse controlled. But it's nice that they give you those options nonetheless. All right, we'll move back there, and back we go. Controller mapping. You can't change this, which is a bit annoying. It shows you where it is, but it doesn't actually tell you whether or not you can change it, which is strange. But it's also not that uncommon. I just wish they wouldn't say mapping when they clearly mean this is a page that tells you what the buttons are, but we're not going to let you remap anything. Ugh. Individual sound sliders, and you can change your listening environment as well to change things like the frequency and EQ. And a benchmark option, which we can run if you like. I can show you that with the current settings, absolutely. Just bear in mind before we start this benchmark, I am currently recording. That means it's going to knock a few frames off here and there. Usually the impact is about 3 to 4 frames per second. Just bear that in mind as we go in and add a couple of frames onto the result. Okay, let's jump into the benchmark. Now, the game currently does not support SLI. I imagine that is going to be put into the game. I cannot imagine them not doing that, especially when the game is branded with NVIDIA. So, I don't think there's any doubt that that will eventually come in, but in the pre-release version, basically a day before it came out, it doesn't have SLI support. Alright, and you see the frame rate in the corner there. So, it's staying above 60 pretty much constantly. Slight dip there, but bear in mind I'm shaving a couple of frames off with the recording software. So it's mostly 60, but every now and again you will see a drop, which is maybe a little bit surprising. I would say that the benchmark is very intensive compared to the full game. So you are not going to see poor performance on a system like this in the game. It runs 99.9% of the time over 60 frames per second. It's also inexplicably capped at 100, which is very, very odd. But the benchmark isn't, which makes me scratch my head. 100 is a really weird number. There you can see average FPS 66.52. It apparently at some point dropped down to 32, but that must have been for a microsecond, because I did not see that at all. So with the recording software off, it averages around 70 to 72 frames per second on this system, which seems fine from what I can tell. And you know my specs there in the about page. So overall, performance is actually pretty good. I haven't had any problems, really. At least once I knocked the ambient occlusion down to high from ultra, it seemed to be just fine. And I've never really noticed any massive frame drops. If anything, it's been down to maybe 55 in really intensive areas with a lot of lighting effects. Outside of that, it stayed above 60 and it's felt smooth. Okay, let's jump into the game. So my first impressions are based on 8.5 hours of gameplay. And you might be thinking, well, that's more than enough, right? Yes and no, I did want to do a bit more of it because part of the so-called nemesis system involves the ability to brand orcs and also send them on missions against other people and do all this kind of intrigue stuff. But it's very far into the game to actually get that. I've been cracking on with the story missions. It says on the skill tree that I need to do story missions to unlock that ability. I still haven't done it. And I've been playing and I had to stop at some point because, yeah, as I said, I only have limited time to do this. So my apologies. I will not be able to tell you about the branding system, but I can tell you about everything else. So let's jump in, shall we? And continue. All right, welcome to Shadow of Mordor. What the hell happened to my face? A good question. Well, I probably won't answer too much of it because it's a bit spoilerific, but as you can see, that does not look like the main character, does it? No, indeed not. You are, I wouldn't say possessed by, but certainly in some way attached to the wraith of some sort of elf from a bygone age. I won't tell you anything else because that ends up being a spoiler. All right, we sit here atop a tower. These towers cover the open world, as you can see right here. There's actually more than one open world map, by the way, as you will discover later on. This is not the only open world area, although it is of reasonable size regardless. You can discover these blue towers by going into the Wraith world, which I'm currently in. I'm actually not in it right now, but if I come down here and then do this, then that will put me kind of into the Wraith world, which is, needless to say, extremely reminiscent of the effect that you saw in the Lord of the Rings movies when Frodo put on the ring. This gives you a number of advantages. It's quite like the Batman detective mode, but it also gives you a bunch of disadvantages. You can barely see anything in this mode. So while it makes it much easier to see enemies, it makes it much more difficult to see terrain. And more often than not, you can see things behind terrain, try and shoot it, and then suddenly realize, oh yeah, there's terrain in the way. That's completely and totally useless. It does make it a lot easier to find hidden collectibles. So let's talk about the open world mechanics. Then we'll go into the combat, talk about a little bit about the nemesis system, performance, graphics, conclusion, and all that kind of stuff. So on the open world, you will see a number of different icons. These represent side missions for the most part. Now, the gold ones, which you won't see on this map because it's actually on the other map right now, are main story missions, of which there are 20. I am, I think, on either 12 or 13. I'm actually quite far into this. About 10 hours, 10 and a half, according to the profile page. And these are required, needless to say, to advance the story, as well as unlock a bunch of different abilities. The side missions, well, they will reward you with the various currencies of the game, whether it be power, some middle or earth bollocks, which begins with an M. I don't know what that is, but it's something that is used to unlock attribute points. And then you also just gain experience as well. Now, all of these are completely optional. As you can see here, these are outcast missions, which involve rescuing slaves. You've got these missions right here, which are optional bow challenges. There are also sword and knife challenges. These will allow you to unlock additional tiers of attributes that will upgrade your weapons, and eventually you will gain this really powerful ultimate ability by forging the legend of a certain named bow from bygone ages. Now, these red icons represent a bunch of side missions that are tied into the game's so-called nemesis system, which I will explain a little bit later on. But they're rewarded with power, and these are fairly dynamic. These will change the further you go into the game. All of these side missions, they're going to be there pretty much forever, but these, if you advance time, will actually resolve themselves. And that's tied into the way that the orc hierarchy works and the struggle for power amongst the orc captains and war chiefs. Outside of that, you can use fast travel to travel pretty much anywhere you like, and then you can circumnavigate the world. I guess it wouldn't be circumnavigating, considering we're not running on a sphere and a circle, but you can navigate the world on foot for the most part. You can climb up pretty much anything. A lot of people compared this game to Assassin's Creed, and I can certainly see why that would be, although it's certainly a lot more like Batman as far as I'm concerned. You can climb up pretty much anything without too much of a problem, and it's also possible once you unlock the ability to start to gain speed by doing just a little bit of parkour, by jumping over low obstacles, you're able to kind of gain speed, kind of like this. And then you hit the spacebar again, and you can run very, very fast. Now, it's also possible to mount on various beasts. The default beast you can mount on, the Caragorn, is one of these fellas right here. It's a little bit difficult to gain control over. You have to jump at it from a height. I believe there are some abilities which make it a little bit easier. But if I jump on top of here, then I should be able to then jump on it. And then I can dominate it and ride it around. And this unlocks some mounted combat benefits. It also lets you run up cliffs with it. And it's a fairly powerful and fast way to get around the world if you're not using fast travel. And they've limited the fast travel quite nicely by only putting one tower in each region, so you still have to travel a fair bit. This is especially true when you're going through strongholds, which are very, very large areas with lots of orcs. And if you raise the alarm there, you're going to have hundreds of the damn things on you, so you do want to be a little bit careful. There we go, so that's me riding around on a Caragorn. Nice and easy. So that's how the open world works for the most part. There are various collectibles, which you'll find all over the place, artifacts and Ithildin, which you can collect. And there's also things like survival and hunting challenges, like kill five ranged kill five flying creatures, not ranged creatures, and then you gain an experience bonus for that, and so on and so forth. And that all ties in to this system right here, which is the way that your character progresses. So there are three main currencies in the game: experience, power, and this thing, which it's M. We'll just call it M. It's Mithras, some elven bollocks. But this is used as a currency to unlock various tiers of attributes. It usually upgrades things like the number of elf shot, the spectral arrows that you've got, the spirit arrows. Also allows you to gain additional health and unlock rune slots for your weapons, and then eventually unlock these ultimate upgrades for each of your three main weapons. Fairly simple. And most of that you will gain from collecting artifacts and doing those little collectible missions. Abilities are unlocked with experience. You get XP from pretty much everything you do. And then you unlock each tier by growing in power, which will involve killing orc captains within the Nemesis system. So as you can see, I'm down to the fourth of five tiers available here, and I've unlocked a bunch of this stuff. Some of it is tied into story missions like this, for instance. You can unlock the ability to ride that, which sounds hilarious. And you can also unlock the ability to mount Caragors much easier than you currently have and things like that. You can even mount them instantly with Shadow Strike, which is a nice teleportation ability. And you get all sorts of different things. You can get Shoulder Barge, you can get a bunch of passives. It's a fairly good choice of stuff, honestly, and I've only unlocked, as you can see, not all of the abilities yet. There's still quite a lot of stuff that I need to get a hold of, and you progress at a reasonable pace, I would say. And some of this stuff is really interesting. Some of it's very useful, like resilience is great because it means that you can't have your combo interrupted by a single hit. Very useful for getting up very high combo numbers and all that kind of thing. So the progression is, you know, it's reasonably simple to understand. I've actually done 14 out of 20 main missions. Wow. Yeah, I've been cracking mostly on the main missions because there was a particular ability called Brand that I wanted to unlock because it was key to explaining the Nemesis system fully. So I worked away pretty feverishly at that and ignored a lot of the other stuff. I mean, you could probably beat this game in about 10 hours if you only did the main story missions, but in doing that, you'd also be completely defeating the point of playing an open world game. Now, the other form of progression is in terms of runes, and these are dropped randomly by orc captains and war chiefs. And there are ways to increase the chance of getting a good one, but for the most part, it is determined fairly randomly. And you can rune up to five things in each of your three weapons, the sword, the bow, and the dagger. There are epic runes, and then there are blue runes, which have levels on them, and these runes will increase in power depending on the level. And most of these are percentage-based stat triggers. So 55% chance to recover 25 health on a head explosion kill. 32% chance to get an automatic critical strike on the first hit in a hit streak chain. And then Fell Voices, which is an epic, recover all focus and all health for killing a captain or a war chief. So the epic ones have usually a very static effect, whereas everything else is percentage-based proc chance stuff, which is actually quite interesting. I like the proc chance stuff for the most part. I think it makes things intriguing. It also gives you a reason to continue to hunt for more of the same kind of rune and just kind of get a better version of it. So, like, it did, as you can see, I've got two versions of Betrayer here. One's level 5, one's level 8. And if you exploit various weaknesses within the Orc Captains, you'll be able to get higher level runes. And you can get rid of a bunch of stuff as well, if you so desire. You can simply convert them into the Elven Bollocks, and then you can spend that on other abilities. So there isn't a crafting system per se, but if you've got multiple runes that you'd... I mean, I don't think I'm going to use any of these, so I'm just going to convert that into M. There we go. Bit fiddly. Would be nice to do multiple things at once, honestly. But I don't think you really get enough runes for that to be a problem. Just kind of stay on top of your inventory and everything will be, for the most part, just fine. So the rune system is pretty good, and I'm still looking for all sorts of interesting runes and effects to tie together and make interesting combinations. So yeah, the rune system is not too bad. I like it quite a lot, but the randomness does get a little bit annoying. The next time I end up getting a rune that's like, you get plus this to shooting while mounted. Like, I don't use that. Come on. That's not going to happen. So it can get a little bit annoying at times, but there are, as I said, ways and means of making certain runes appear. If you kill an Orc Captain with a specific weakness to a certain weapon, you will get a rune for that weapon. And there's also ways to increase your chance of epic rune drops and things like that. All right, cool. So we've gone through the progression system. We've gone through how that ties into the open world. Let's look at the actual combat, shall we? I'm mounted, so this sounds like a perfect time to go and jump on a patrol of orcs and kill them. There we go. So this is how the mounted combat works. It is not in any way difficult. They're actually chasing a bunch of slaves right now, so we're going to make sure that that doesn't end up happening. I'm going to knock him over and then eat him with the Caragor. The mounted combat's probably the weakest part of the game, at least in terms of the Caragor anyway. Maybe the larger creature is a little bit more interesting. But as it stands, the kind of regular mounted combat is not particularly engaging, but it's nice for getting around quickly, and it also can get you out of a dangerous situation. Now, the stuff on foot, you've got all sorts of things. As you can see here, I've got this kind of teleport arrow, which I can use, which briefly turns me into that elven wraith. And I can grab people and shank them, no problem at all. There are various finisher moves, which are attached into the combat system, which, as you can probably see, is very much like Arkham. Rightfully so, is the comparison made. But this time around, what I will say is that this game does the Arkham stuff very, very well indeed. And in order to demonstrate just how effective that is, we're going to go jump into a mission. There we go. Invade Bolg the Angry's Feast. That sounds like a good idea. It might actually be a bad idea, but if it ends up being a bad idea, it will be a fantastic opportunity to show you how the Nemesis system works in action. There we go. Cool, we have a Vendetta mission as well. I'll probably try and take that on a little bit later. All right, up we go. So we're going to start this mission right here, which will trigger in around the same area. There doesn't seem to be any kind of magical teleportation, although I was a little bit disappointed to see that the events don't happen dynamically in the world. They're triggered when you go and start the mission. Although, after a certain amount of time, which usually passes either when you die or when you go onto a tower and force the time to pass deliberately, these missions will resolve themselves and new missions will appear. All right. Cool, so he's actually a power 13 elite captain. This could be quite difficult, but this gives me a great opportunity to demonstrate the full reach of the combat system. So if we head into this mission, this guy is attempting to have a feast in order to raise his power and make himself more popular. He is an orc captain. Now, if I disrupt this feast, I could weaken him, or indeed I could end up killing him or bringing him into my control. That is entirely possible. So I could jump into the middle of this, and in fact, I'm probably going to do that just so that I can demonstrate exactly how it works. I'm going to start by stabbing him with a stealth kill right there, and then we'll go and engage him. There we go. All right. He's actually killed me before, by the way, so he's actually going to mention that we fought before, which is kind of great, I've got to say. It really adds a personal element to the combat, but we're going to attack him, attempt to raise up our stats right here. Look for maybe an 8x combo if possible, and then maybe we can do a finishing move, which is not enough to kill him as a boss. He's not vulnerable to that, but there are other creatures that are. Now, we have the right-click counter system, as you probably noticed, very much from Arkham. Ow! This guy is not messing around. He's got a number of interesting and dangerous abilities. So you can counter pretty much anything as long as you do it at the right time, with the exception of some of these heavier pole-armed guys, which really require you to dodge out of the way. And they also have shields, which mean that it's much more difficult to actually do damage from the front. We can execute him, I think. Actually, we messed that up, so never mind. Ow. Please stop that. You can bounce very easily between the multiple characters on the screen simply by pressing in the vague direction, and it's reasonably accurate, although, as I've mentioned before, chances are you probably want... I'm gonna grab him now, actually, and then we can turn him to our cause by branding him. Well, at least we can try once we've dealt with these bastards. There we go. One and two in the head, and then maybe one more. That's what I like to see. You might want to use a controller for that, although I found the keyboard and mouse to be absolutely fine. I've had no problems with the keyboard and mouse controls whatsoever. The bloody archer! God damn it. Actually, it's a hunter. There we go. Alright, you want to give that another bash? Alright. Now we should be able to dominate him. That's what I like to see. Good, good, good. Yeah, I found the controls actually to be completely fine. They don't seem to have any problems whatsoever. The only thing that I would say about it, which I have actually mentioned before, is that... Who shall I have him go and murder? Should we have him betray this war chief? Yeah, there we go. I've now created a power struggle between the two of them, which is something that I can then help him out on. Sweet. There we go. The only thing I would say is that a couple of buttons have multiple uses, and as a result, the game can get a little bit confused about which one you're using, but that's going to be a problem with the controller as well as the keyboard and mouse. But otherwise, the keyboard and mouse controls I found to be totally fine, and the rhythmic combat is very reminiscent of Arkham. But the thing is, it does it very, very well, and a lot of games that have tried to imitate Arkham have not done it all that well. I'd give an example of Remember Me, or probably the worst example, Kick-Ass 2, that did an absolutely dreadful job of attempting to imitate the Arkham system. This time around, it's really, really good, and there are a number of reasons. Let me explain why, rather than just giving you some vapid statement with no meaning. The reason why I believe that it does a good job in imitating the Arkham combat system is, one, the combat is extremely responsive. If you have a prompt on the screen that says you can counter, 100% of the time you're going to be able to counter it. You never feel like the game is cheating you in that regard. Secondly, the animation quality is very, very high, which means that you're able to couple things like shanks and stealth kills, the wraith flurries and the various different abilities, along with finishes and executions and counters together to make a very fluid combat experience. And it looks great pretty much all the time, which is fantastic. Your character organically flows from move to move in a way that makes sense. And that is critical for making this system work. It's got to be responsive, and that's got to be tied into the animation quality and the way that the various different chains of animations actually couple together, which thankfully in this case is very, very good indeed. I gotta say, the animations are some of the high points when it comes to the aesthetic of this game, but we'll talk a little bit more about the aesthetic later on. So that's how the combat works. You've got your bow combat right here, which ties into a focus system, allowing it to slow down time. It also allows you to actually chase people, which is a bit of a weird thing. I don't think it was necessarily designed to allow you to do that, but if you go into bow mode with focus and then you run towards them, you'll actually catch up to people that are running much quicker, which is a bit of a weird way to use it, but it seems to work just fine. And then you have a rudimentary stealth system, which works fine. Unfortunately, the game does love to force you to use it from time to time in some of the main story missions, which means that the game has a bunch of instant failure states, which I am not a big fan of. I mean, that's very much a personal thing for me. I don't like stealth missions with instant failure states. I like there to be a reason why you don't want to be detected, but I don't want you being detected to be the end of the mission. This is especially true because the game's checkpoints are not necessarily as generous as perhaps they could be, which results in you having to redo parts of the game over and over if you fail a stealth section. That said, the orcs, for the most part, do not really do a great job of noticing where you are, and they take a while to detect you, so it's not really that big a problem, and if you're just competent at the whole stealth system, then you're not going to have to worry too much about failing. Outside of that, it's just a case of sneak, hide in bushes. You can use an attraction ability to bring orcs towards you and then shank them from inside a bush. You can shoot from a high place where they don't recognize you. And it's got the good old, here's the outline of where the orcs think you are system, which allows you to move around and be generally stealthy. And indeed, a lot of the Warchief fights actually require stealth because engaging them head on is not generally a great idea. You want to try and draw them away from their bodyguard so you can pick them off easier. It's really as simple as that. So that's the combat system there for you. Now, I've been talking about this nemesis system a lot, and a lot of you are possibly wondering what the nemesis system actually involves, and whether or not it is as good as some of the pre-release previews claimed. Now, you saw a little bit of it going on earlier. With that informant, or so-called worm orc, I was able to dominate his mind, read his mind, and find out some information about one of the orc captains. This allows me to get a hold of some of his weaknesses, which will allow me to hunt him down and make things an awful lot easier. It also gives you bonuses if you exploit his weaknesses when it comes to the rune drop, so it's all pretty damn good. But the nemesis system goes way further than that. So let's have a look at Sauron's army. This is Sauron's army currently. As you can see, he's got a lot of dead orcs in here. He will eventually replenish his ranks, and he will promote new orcs to become captains in his army. This is a captain. These are veteran captains, elite captains, actually, Okay, I was completely wrong about that. So there are various kinds of captains. There are veteran captains, elite captains, and regular captains. And generally, the closer the captains are to the back, the more powerful they're going to be. And that usually also means they're connected in some way to the war chiefs, which are five very, very powerful orcs indeed. And eventually, elite captains can get promoted to war chiefs, or indeed they can get into power struggles, as you can see earlier. I was able to dominate Balg the Angry, brand him, take control of him, and I ordered him to betray the war chief that he was the bodyguard for. Yeah? So Kaka Eye Gouger is going to have a power struggle with Balg the Angry. Now, if I help Balg the Angry out, then I am going to be able to replace the war chief with Balg the Angry, who I have control over. However, I could also let Balg the Angry die. I could set it up in such a way that I just want them to fight and weaken each other, and hopefully the war chief then ends up killing Balg. But as these guys fight each other in the various red events, they will gain power. You generally want to prevent that from happening, because the higher the power each of the captain is, well, the more abilities they happen to have. And we know Balg the Angry's abilities, but as you can see here, he has a lot of strengths. He's invulnerable to ranged, invulnerable to stealth, he's battle-hardened, he has explosive arrows, he's fearless. He's got a lot of stuff that he can do, and the higher level someone gets, the more strengths they're going to get and the less weaknesses, which makes them a lot harder to deal with. And these captains can be very dangerous, and they will kill you. And if they do kill you, they gain power. Indeed, even if you have a grunt kill you, they will be automatically promoted to a captain, and they'll remember you as well. And you get a mission to go and take revenge on this guy that killed you. Now, what this allows you to do is contextualize all of these little mini boss fights. You end up having a motivation to kill these characters because they have messed with you in the past. And the thing is, they remember that as well. They even remember small things like whether or not you burned them. And that will actually be represented on their face as well. If you threw them into a fire or whatever, and they survive, they'll remember that and they'll mention it. And they also do things like remember it if they killed you, or remember it if they ran away and you actually let them escape. All of that is frankly pretty damn fantastic, and it's a really cool way of contextualizing all of your actions, giving you a personal motivation to hunt these bastards down. And it also makes dying an interesting progression, as opposed to just a, hey, gotta go do that again. Every time you die in this game, the timeline is going to advance, these events are going to resolve, the orcs are going to gain more power, and they're going to change in abilities. And if one of these guys killed you, he's going to gain status and recognition as a direct result. And that in itself is fantastic. That's a brilliant way to make the death failure state actually mean something in terms of the game's actual mechanics, and make everything more interesting. It's actually kind of cool to lose one of those events, because then you can go back later and fight him, and everything's changed, and there's more power struggles going on, and you inadvertently cause that by failing, which I absolutely love. Now, we had a Vendetta mission offered to us. Where was that? It may be on the other map. Oh, it's actually over here. Okay, so I fast traveled to that. Now, I am in with this Vendetta mission. This is actually connected to one of these good old passive multiplayer elements of the game. I'm actually taking revenge for the death of another player here by going on this Vendetta mission. This will allow me to gain power. And it's pretty cool because you see the name of the guy that got killed, and it even tracks things like stats as to how many times the orc captain actually killed that fellow. That's kind of neat. I mean, it doesn't make a lot of sense within the universe, per se, because you are really the only character. It's very much a strange mechanical contrivance, but I like it on the level of it just being an interesting thing to do. And the game does have quite a lot to do. But here's perhaps where the biggest problem of the game lies. Everything that the game has you do involves killing orcs. So it's all tied into the combat system in some way, which means that the game is really reliant on you enjoying the combat. If you don't enjoy the combat, then you are going to run into some serious problems when it comes to enjoying the game's fairly repetitive nature. It tries, it genuinely tries to vary things up, but it can't hide the fact that the game is just about killing orcs. Everything that you do in it is involving the death of orcs in some way. Even the system that they use for the manipulation of the various orcs, the nemesis system, allowing you to kind of build your own orc army, that's still about killing orcs. It's just about doing it in a slightly less direct way. Now, the combat system is good, as I've explained before. It's actually very, very good. It has a decent amount of variety. There are a decent number of ways to kill the enemy, especially once you unlock more abilities. You're basically getting gadgets in the same way that you would in the Arkham series with the various Wraith abilities. I like the fact that you can kind of break out in the middle of combat, slow things down, and just start headshotting people. I like the ability to terrorize the orcs by making people's heads explode and also detonating fires and barrels of grog to set people on fire, letting loose Karagors, Far Cry style. Whoa, what's going on over there? Something's exploding. We should probably go over there and check it out. Is this him? It looks like it is. Okay, he has a fear of Karagors and can be damaged by combat finishes. Okay, if I could find a Karagor, then I should be able to avenge his death quite handily. The question is, will we be able to find one? There should be one around here somewhere. That would be wonderful. That would make things a lot easier. Otherwise, it's probably going to be a fairly tough fight. Not seeing anyone around here. Maybe we'll just head further towards that. But outside of all of that, everything's about killing orcs. Everything. So if you get bored by Arkham-style combat, then you're probably going to run into some issues, I think. That could be a problem. I actually do have a captain of mine that could maybe help me out here. That might be an interesting thing to do. I'm going to bring him... in. I think I may have actually told him to go and fight a bunch of the enemy orcs within that stronghold, which is probably not what I was looking to do. Whoops! Okay. Well, I've caused chaos over here. My orc captain's just killing everybody. Uh-oh. I'm gonna run away now. I'm gonna head over here instead. I'm causing myself a bunch of problems. I think that you've got to take the game for what it is, which is an open-world combat experience. And as a result, you've got to understand the game is going to be primarily about combat with a little bit of exploration. There are some cool things to find. Like earlier, I was able to find myself a rather lovely little item, which gave me kind of audio log. I don't think there's actually a Karagor in there. No, it doesn't look like it. That's a shame. I was able to find that audio log, which, annoyingly enough, requires you to stay in the page to actually listen to, which is pretty stupid. That's something that they really need to fix. You should be able to walk around while listening to those audio logs. But outside of looking for collectibles, you're gonna be fighting orcs. Thankfully, it does fighting orcs pretty damn well. And the element of manipulation and having the feeling that you're actually some figure from the shadows that is trying to manipulate things, particularly later on in the game, I think adds a nice bit of flavor to the whole thing. In fact, I go out of my way to try and deliberately manipulate these various fights, cause Karagor to fight against orcs, let loose clouds of flies, and use little distractions to reach my target. In fact, what I'm doing here is I am branding all of these orcs so that I can then command them to betray the fellow that I'm trying to hunt over here. Which I imagine is going to work fairly well. It should do, certainly. There we go. Alright, cool. So I've got like 3 or 4 orcs to help me out here. So I'm now going to order them to fight. There we go. And, oh, I'm actually not in range. Let's try it now. There we go. Okay. Now they should go and fight. This should make things very interesting indeed. I'm going to teleport to him, and then I'm going to try and brand him. Oh, I'm draining him. There we go. All right, so I now have my little orc army that's actually going to come and help, which should make this fight a lot easier. So if it is a game about killing orcs, it's a game that does killing orcs really, really well. And as long as you don't get bored of that, you're probably going to be just fine with it. I would say that the combat can get a bit repetitive. I think it's really down to the nature of Arkham combat, which is this good old bounce between enemies until you gain enough points to actually pull off a finisher, and then kill the orc and then move on to the next one. And if you're fighting a large group, you're often just kind of bouncing between them over and over and over again in order to get counters and knock over the various orcs. But if you enjoy that system, you're going to very much enjoy indulging in the way that Shadow of Mordor does things. Now, let's talk about performance and things like graphical fidelity. So, for the most part, the game looks pretty good, though I have to say, I'm not exactly convinced by the idea that the texture quality in this game is worthy of 3 gigs of video RAM. That, I don't know about that. Even things like the cloth textures on the main character's clothing and the wall textures in certain places, I mean, that looks fine, but if we get up nice and close, some of that stuff is actually pretty low resolution, as you can see. It's nicely concealed by the fact that it has this nice rain slick effect, and that the overall aesthetic design, while being sort of fairly samey, because hey, it's Mordor, it's gonna look like Mordor at the end of the day, there's not that much you can actually do with it. The overall texture quality is quite low. Things like the hair on the characters don't look particularly good either, so it's not all that pleasing to the eye, I've got to say. But it is a nice big open world with very few loading screens and reasonable view distance, as you can see. You can see quite far, and if I turn on my vision, I can actually see quite far away. In many cases, I can see orcs all the way over there that are still rendering. So it's not the best looking game ever, but it's certainly a pretty solid looker. And the animation quality combined with the high quality of voice acting and writing in this game, that's very Middle Earth-esque, there's no doubt about that. The main character's voice actor is great. In fact, I actually haven't found a bad voice actor. All the orc voice actors are pretty good too, although they all sound fairly similar. They've all got that fairly gruff British voice, which I suppose is to be expected. Just in terms of production values, while I can snark away at the texture quality, which, by the way, I'm not running an ultra because they don't have that pack available yet, I can still say that the game looks pretty good for the most part. Now, performance-wise, it also runs pretty well. Now, I mentioned earlier that it doesn't use SLI yet. I imagine that by the time you've watched this video, they'll probably have a driver to support that. The game runs with the settings that I showed you earlier, the 99% of the time at 60 FPS or over. But there are occasions where it drops, particularly on the second map, though I found some areas that actually dropped it down to more like 50. But that's very rare, and it doesn't happen for all that often. I mean, right now it's about 60, 70 right now, which you might be surprised by. It's like, wow, look at those lighting effects. Is it really running high frame rate here? Yeah, absolutely. It is. Seems like a lot of foliage density tends to knock the frame rate down a little bit, so you could maybe mess around with that in the tessellation options. But there isn't a driver for this game yet, so I have a feeling that's got a lot to do with it. With SLI on, I fully expect this game to run absolutely fine. There are definitely concerns with the amount of memory that they claim is required for the texture quality, and I don't think that texture quality justifies that, frankly. I really, really don't. I mean, do you really think that that wall texture quality justifies 3 gigs of video memory and all that stuff? It is an open world game, so there's a lot to be rendered at any given time, but I'm still not 100% convinced by that. So it might cause some problems for some people. You're going to have to look at impressions from those with different machines. On my single Titan, the game runs 99% of the time at 60 or above, and that's totally acceptable. And I very, very rarely get any sort of slowdown effect. And that's without the proper drivers, so I gotta say, like, while some people might think that this is probably not a very good PC port, I would have to disagree with that assertion. I think it's actually, for the most part, a very good PC port indeed. So, conclusion. Is it any good? The answer, if you like killing orcs, it's very, very good. The Nemesis system is a very interesting innovation. It's the sort of thing that I've seen tried, although not in such a very specific and focused way before in a open world action game. There's a lot of open world action games that do the whole play this faction against each other thing, but for the most part, you're not even able to really do that. Here, you are quite literally able to send captains against each other in battles. I'm not going to avenge the death of Ohm Wrecker. Absolutely not. Oh, dear. Okay. I can go and help him out here. Let's actually go do that. I'll just fast travel to this area. Ah, and something's happened in the meantime, by the way, as I fast traveled. Oh, a duel went on between these two, so someone got killed. The whole thing just feels really, really dynamic because it's focused on this idea of the orc hierarchy that you can directly influence. And that feeling of power is kind of fantastic, I've got to say. I think they could have maybe done a little bit more with it from a storytelling standpoint, because I would have loved to learn more about orc society, but all I've really learned from this game so far in 10 hours is orcs are violent bastards, they beat and kill slaves, they like to eat men, and they fight all the time. I think they could have maybe gone a bit further into that. They did make like one interesting orc character that's at the start of the game, but outside of that, you're mostly fighting these captains that really just have a few lines each. And while it makes it interesting contextually when you're fighting them, I would love to know a lot more about them and just about the way that orc society works in general. There's one mission where you sneak into a stronghold and you can hear those orcs in a tavern kind of with their own orc drinking songs and everything. That's all really, really good theme, and that's great window dressing, but I would like to know a little bit more. And I think that this game had the opportunity to go there but decided against that, which is maybe a little bit of a shame. It's not like the game is 90% combat anyway. I think they could have maybe fit in just a little bit of kind of diplomatic aspect to it outside of the way that this works, or they could simply have gone for just a bit more storytelling from the orc point of view. There might be a little bit more later on, but as I said, I'm almost, I think, 3/4 of the way through the main story missions, and I haven't really seen much of that outside of one character. So if I was to point to a weakness in the storytelling, it would be that. Outside of that, though, the cutscenes were actually enthralling, just because of very high-quality voice acting, and they seem to have tied the plot quite nicely into some of the Tolkien works. Not directly into The Lord of the Rings, actually some more of the lesser-known stuff. They were able to tie it in quite nicely there. So, from what I could see, this is a really nicely polished product. It does open world action game very, very well indeed. It does Arkham combat exceptionally well. I would say it is as good, if not in some areas, just because of the way that you can really manipulate the various orcs, actually slightly better than the Arkham series. The Nemesis system is a triumph, and I would love to see more systems like that in future games. I love this idea of pitting people against each other and being a very powerful character, but also doing a lot of stuff from the shadows. That's something I really enjoy doing. And this game allows you to do that, although it does take a long time to be able to unlock the brand ability. So you're going to be over halfway through the game before you can really do anything of the sort. Though you've got to admit that it's nice that the game paced out some of the main mechanics so far instead of blowing all its load really, really early. The stealth system is functional, if a little bit basic. Occasionally you can do dodgy things like that and jump through walls, although I have otherwise found no bugs with the game whatsoever. Nothing in my playthrough so far, which is quite impressive. You know, it looks like they really did great QA here. I don't see all that many dodgy things outside of the weird sort of stealth kills sometimes interfering with the geometry in some way. It's a decent enough game to look at. Not the most amazing, but still some interesting and impressive vistas, I've got to say, although I think it's hampered by its own subject matter there. You can't really make Mordor look all that interesting, frankly. So what are you going to do? It's ruins and sulfur and wasteland. That's really all it is. Thankfully, you do get a second map later down the line, which does vary things up a little bit, which I do approve of, thank God, because I was getting a little bit bored of looking at regular Mordor. But so far, I've been having a really good time with it. Every now and again, I get a little bit frustrated because things get a bit repetitive or because one of the missions has some mandatory stealth nonsense that I don't really enjoy. There's maybe a little bit too much follow the leader involved in some of the main story missions as well. But all of the side missions, you're really able to approach in your own way. And the way that the open world is designed allows for plenty of sneaking about, using height to your advantage, picking off people one at a time. I mean, hell, in many ways, it's more Assassin's Creed than Assassin's Creed is, which should be a little bit telling, I suppose, of how samey Assassin's Creed has really got. If you like the Arkham combat system, I would say that you're probably going to enjoy Shadow of Mordor a great deal. I can't speak too much to what it does to the lore. Of course, I've read Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, and I'm well aware of most of the lore then. I've played quite a lot of the games and read some of the sub-material, but I don't know how much of it really messes with. I'm not going to comment on that. That's really something that you're probably going to have to find out for yourself. But as an action game with a strong theme and a really interesting system in the form of Nemesis, this is a really fun single-player action adventure. I can dig it. I absolutely can dig it. There you go, folks. Shadow of Mordor, which should be available right now on Steam for the regular full price of $60 or your regional equivalent. It's also available on PlayStation 4. As well as Xbox One. I believe it's on the previous gen consoles as well, but good lord, why you'd want to play it on that, I cannot imagine. Definitely a game best played on stronger hardware. Great. Really good. Good to see Monolith returning to form. One of my all-time favorite developers from a long time ago, but you know, lately they haven't been putting out some good stuff. This is the AAA quality and dedication to some interesting systems and innovation while in otherwise a fairly stagnant genre that I would have expected from Monolith. So I guess it's up to me to say welcome back. Let's see some more good stuff from you. My name's been Total Biscuit. Thank you very much for watching. This has been Middle-Earth Shadow of Mordor, and I'll see you next time.